So I'm George Eleftheriades from the University of Toronto, and today I will like to share with you our excitement over the past few years with metamaterials and how we can use them for the extreme manipulation of electromagnetic waves, including how to make invisibility cloaks. So, in order to explain all of this, I need to tell you a little bit about electromagnetic waves. Now, if you don't know it, they are actually all around us, even in this room. So these are electric and magnetic energy oscillations that propagate in empty space at the speed of light, an astonishing 300,000 kilometers per second. Most of these waves are actually invisible, but yet they are used in everyday wireless devices, such as smartphones, Wi-Fi routers, wireless keys, and even microwave ovens. So these are radio waves and microwaves, but also visible light and X-rays are a form of electromagnetic waves. So what's the difference between all these waves? Well, picture a pebble falling in the water. Then this will create ripples, waves. So having this wave picture in mind, I can tell you what's the difference. So you see, there is a characteristic distance between two successive peaks in this wave motion, which is called the wavelength. Now, the wavelength is measured in centimeters for radio waves and microwaves, but for light is much, much shorter, like a thousandth of half a millimeter. So that's the difference. Now, on the other hand, metamaterials is a new field in which we try to make engineered materials, materials that do not exist in nature, but which have unusual electromagnetic properties, such as a negative index of refraction. So how do they look like? Well, I show you here a collection of metamaterials. The first two on the left are for microwaves and radio waves, and for the one on the right is for manipulating light. So it has a much finer structure. But anyway, this is just some boring science. The question is, what can we do with them? Well, we can manipulate electromagnetic waves in extreme ways. We can make light bend negatively, and I will explain what's this. We can make lenses that have entirely flat surfaces and yet they can focus light. We can use these lenses to see details with a microscope that was thought to be impossible before, very tiny details. And finally, they can even be used for making invisibility cloaks. Okay, so let's start this discussion by examining one of the most fundamental phenomena when light interacts with matter, such as glass. So if you have a light beam impinging on a piece of glass obliquely, then the light bends. And this bending is called refraction. Now, refraction is responsible for making eyeglasses and magnifying glasses. And the amount of light bending, the amount of bending, depends on a property called the index of refraction. So for glass, the index of refraction is 1.6. For diamond is 2.4. So much more bending for diamond, and that's why it's so much more shiny than glass. So the law really that connects the angle of incidence, the angle of refraction, and the index of refraction is called Snell's law and was established 400 years ago, more than 400 years ago. And yet it's only recently, in the past 10 to 15 years, that we found ways to extend Snell's law and bend light much more extremely. Why? Because today we can engineer metamaterials with a negative index of refraction. So this is our unusual electromagnetic property that I was talking about. So let's see what that, what this means when we have a light beam impinging on a piece of glass, this red material there. Well, as I mentioned before, light will bend slightly. Why? Because the light slows down in glass. But if we make this glass to have a negative index of refraction, look what happens. Light bends much more extremely, almost bends backwards and falls back to itself. So with this extreme way of bending light, we can envision new and exciting lenses, such as this Veselako-Pendry lens, which is just a slab, so it has completely flat surfaces, and yet it can focus light, unlike any other lens that you are familiar with. So this is a really cool lens. How does it look like? Well, this is a lens that we have constructed in my lab a few years back and can be used to focus microwaves, electromagnetic waves. So actually, you see the focusing that takes place here. Actually, these spots are so tiny that we can extend the resolution of optical devices. And this is shown in the next slide here. So what do we mean by that? So do you think you can take a magnifying glass and look at molecules and atoms? No. Why not? Because they are so much smaller than the wavelength of light. But with this Veselako, these negative index lenses, at least in principle, you can do that. You can go and look at very tiny objects and distances between the objects. So this is called super resolution. And here is how it works. So you see on the right, you see on the right, here, a collection of objects which are very closely spaced, so sub-wavelength spaced. You try to look at them with a lens and you just see a blur image, so you cannot tell them apart. But with one of these super lenses, you can actually resolve them very nicely. So of course you can use this for applications such as for improving the resolution from magnetic resonance imaging apparatus, and that's what we show here. There is a coil next to a human leg. And as you can see on the top panel, the further leg cannot be imaged. But when we insert one of the super lenses in between the two legs, then the second leg becomes visible as well. So these are applications at microwaves, but we can extend this to visible light as well. And this is an example of a super microscope that we have recently constructed in my lab, and what you see here is actually images of two tiny apertures. So on the bottom panel here, you see what happens when you try to resolve these two tiny apertures that are very closely spaced with a conventional microscope. So here they are just barely resolved. This is the minimum distance that you can resolve them. It's called the Rayleigh distance, and it's about half wavelength. If you space these apertures closer together, you cannot tell them apart. But with our super microscope, you see we can tell them apart very nicely, well below this fundamental Rayleigh limit. So this is very exciting because we can take now microscopes, increase their resolution for a number of applications for biology, medicine, material science, and so on. Okay, so this brings me to the last application, which is this invisibility cloaking business. So invisibility has aroused mankind, the imagination of humans since the antiquity. So for example, in ancient Greek mythology, there was this invisibility cloak, invisibility cap of Hades, which supposedly was made out of dog skin. I don't know why. And according to legend, Perseus had to wear it after he slain the monster Gorgon to escape the wrath of her sisters. So in, of course, in most modern times, invisibility has been a main theme for novels such as H.G. Wells' classic novel, The Invisible Man, the Harry Potter movies, and what I grew up, actually, Star Trek. So the cloaked starships of the Romulans. But seriously, how can we make an invisibility cloak? Well, look at this top picture on the left here corner. So let's say we want to make this sphere becoming invisible. So the idea is this. You surround this sphere with a metamaterial shell, and then when a light beam comes from, impinges on the sphere, then the metamaterial shell takes the constituent rays, diverts them around the object, and then they are recombined on the other side to their original trajectories. So for all practical purposes, the object becomes invisible. So this is very nice, actually. And, and you see how, how the metamaterial extremely manipulates light and electromagnetic waves. Now, in my lab, we have experimented with this idea. And you see here a source is like our pebble in the water, creating these cylindrical waves next to a metallic cylinder. So the waves cannot penetrate through the cylinder. You see, they just create a shadow region at the back. But when the cylinder is wrapped with this metamaterial shell, then the cylindrical waves are restored completely as if there was nothing there. If you imagine how the waves will look like if the object was not there, that's what you would see. So practically, this is invisibility. Now, this is very nice, and I would say it's the standard way of making invisibility, if I can use that, invisibility cloaks in the past maybe 4 or 5 years. But there is a problem, though. You see, this metamaterial cloak has to be quite thick, and it becomes thicker and thicker the larger the object you want to cloak. So if you want to cloak yourself, you will need like another thick layer of metamaterial around you. So not very practical. So to solve this problem, we have experimented recently in my lab with another idea of making invisibility cloaks, which we call active metasurface cloaking. I quote so many terms. But let's see how this works. I think it's quite simple, actually, to understand it. So how do we see an object? When light impinges on an object, then light scatters, but it scatters, reflects from the object all over the space. So some of the scattered light reaches our eyes, and that's how we see it. So if we have a way to cancel out the scattered fields, the scattered waves, then only the ambient light will remain, and so the object will look invisible. That's really the idea. How can we achieve that, though? So there is a phenomenon called diffractive interference, which probably you learn even at high school. So when you take two waves and they are the negative of each other and you add them, then they cancel. And so we can use this cancellation phenomenon to make a cloak. And that's what we did, basically. You take the object, you surround it now with a thin surface consisting of antennas. Each antenna locally radiates a wave that cancels the local scattered field wave. So therefore, for all practical purposes, when you cancel the scattered waves, the object again becomes invisible. So this is how it looks like schematically. We take the cylinder, a metallic cylinder, and we surround it with antennas. These tiny loops here that you see are antennas. And then this will create an invisibility cloak. So this is how it looks like in the lab. On the left, you see the metallic cylinder surrounded by these tiny antennas held in place with little styrofoam blocks. Each antenna is connected to a cable. These cables are connected to electronics, as you see here. And then these antennas now radiate and make the object look invisible. So does this work? Well, it works really, really well, actually. So you see a wave comes from the left and hits on the cylinder, and then it scatters all over the place, and at the back, it creates this shadow region. But when we switch on our active cloak, look what happens. The waves just pass right through it as if there was nothing there. So the metallic cylinder literally becomes transparent, completely invisible. So I can show you here an animation. These are the actual measured fields when the waves hit the cylinder without the presence of the cloak. And you see that they just scattered all over the place and they create the shadow region at the back. But when we switch on the cloak, they just pass right through it as if nothing were there. So we, and remember, this is a very thin cloak, so and its thickness doesn't depend on the size of the object. It doesn't depend on the shape of the object. It doesn't depend on the composition of the object. So we think that's a very practical way for making invisibility cloaks, which has a very bright future, or shall we say, an invisible future. So I would like to conclude by saying that the work of metamaterials is truly fascinating. That's what keeps us going and can offer exciting possibilities, sometimes making science fiction becoming reality. Many people in the world are working on this field. They are inventing new ways to manipulate light and making new practical applications. I think the collective goal of this community is that one day these applications can find their way in some practical way, in a manner in our everyday lives. So I would like to finish by acknowledging my present and former PhD students whose names are shown here and really whose work has been really featured in this talk. Thank you very much.